that $200 million, extending it in a way that's going to be broader, does not deal, cannot deal with the issue of climate change and the floods and the...
Oh, no, not at all. That's a whole other area. I just took that on the board. That's a whole other area. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I just had a comment, and we were talking about right now how there's such a little amount of money, like, why can't we organize to do it? Something that reminded me of what you're talking about in Australia, in Venezuela right now, just right from the drought has, you know, they say it's a drought, and there is a drought, but in the last 10 years, there's been this crazy windfall of oil profits in the country. And right now there's about 80% of the country's electricity comes from hydroelectric power.
Right.
And they're saying in May, the state electricity company is saying by May, if nothing is done extreme, the whole country will just, you know, experience the electricity blackout. And, you know, they'll cut your power if you don't reduce your consumption by 20%. They're saying the same thing about the showers. You have to take 5-minute mm-hmm. showers. And a country that has received billions and billions of dollars, you know, over the last 10 years, and a president that's supposed to, you know, be doing things for the people, you know, they still haven't been able to, mm-hmm. you know, solve this in 2 months. It's not a year. It's in 2 months. The whole country might just collapse. Who knows what will happen.
Yeah.
So it's an example of like how something that might be easy to fall to solve isn't being solved because of the leadership.
Oh, listen, the political problems, you know, one of the favorite things that I've talked about in climate change are all the things that China is trying to do. And which is wonderful if you want to live in a totalitarian state. Where, you know, they can just say, you do it, and if you don't do it, you know, maybe a tank runs you over. You know, we don't live in that kind of country here. And, you know, I've been to a lot of discussions where the example of China and its innovations is trying for climate change always comes up. And nobody ever quite answers the question, would it still be happening if it wasn't a totalitarian state? So, you know, the form of government and the political leadership, you're right, it changes the politics, the social, cultural, and economic picture of the country. And there are nations who will not accept certain kinds of help from elsewhere. And then there are natural situations where no matter what you do, you can't solve it. You know, droughts are going to happen, and you know, if the dams are not producing the water, or if the dams are not producing the hydropower, nobody's going to be able to bring water to the other side of the dam to start that government. That's not going to happen. So, you know, there are natural conditions. But there are also, you know, the forms of government and politics of individual nations, which are very, very difficult.
Yeah, I'm wondering what you see as the relationship between population growth and the whole water issue. Can we solve the water issue without being concerned about the inexorable growth of population?
No.
So.
No, well, in the long term, in the short term, yes. Who here has a toilet?
With me?
We have a 5-year long term.
Yeah, no, we've got a couple of pigeons too. You flush drinking water down your toilet every day. I mean, the idea that in the 21st century, the United States, I think, flushes 2 trillion gallons of drinking water a year down their toilets is extraordinary. Again, you know, what's the answer to that? Is the answer to that to turn off the water in your toilet? Well, I don't know. Talk to a New York City apartment dweller about that. I don't think that's the answer. What's the answer to that? It's something as simple as the fact that we use drinking water to flush our toilets. Well, innovation is the answer to that. You know, somehow we have to innovate our water system. You know, eventually we're going to have 2 different kinds of plumbing systems.
Drinking water.
And cities.
But even if we do that, and even if we, by doing that and other things, we reduce our water consumption by percent. If our population goes 50%,
yes,
when we're back at, you know, Anheuser-Busch reduces by a third population. New York City, to me, has built a,
yes,
you know, a $1.2 billion water filtration plant because of population. To me, it's because if we had stabilized our population at 1970 levels, New York City wouldn't have had to filter this wonderful water that we used to have.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it just, I don't see, you know, it seems almost hopeless to me if you don't really, while we're working to fix the water problem,
yeah,
not also working to stop.
If we use and reuse all the water we have, you know, we have enough water for many generations. That does not put off.
You mean generations or multiples of what we have now in terms of population?
No, including the increase in population. You know, if we use and reuse all the water we use, which we don't do, you know, almost all the water we use is wasted water. Very little of it is water that we actually use for consumption. Most of it is wasted water. Even like I said, making beer, it takes 5 bottles to make 1 bottle of beer. So, you know, I think it's possible. On the other hand, you're putting your finger on probably the core environmental problems we're talking about, water and climate change.